Steph, oh, Steph, are we ready?
Yes.
Okay. I got about 30 seconds. Wait for Judge to get in. Good afternoon. Good afternoon and welcome to the Planning Commission meeting. The members of the Durham Planning Commission have been appointed by the City Council and the County Board of Commissioners as an advisory board to the elected officials. You should know that the elected officials have the final say on any issue before us tonight. If you wish to speak to an item tonight, please go to the table to my left and sign up to speak. For those of you who wish to speak, please state your name and address clearly when you come to the podium, and please speak clearly into the microphone. Please consult the planning department for any details about your project. You should keep in constant contact with the planning department as things may change between the time it comes from us to the elected officials. Finally, all motions are stated in the affirmative, so if a motion is fails or ties, the recommendation is for denial. Thank you. Can we have a roll call, please?
Mr. Bryan?
Present.
Mr. Busby?
Present.
Ms. Freeman?
Present.
Mr. Ghosh?
Present.
Mr. Gibbs?
Present.
Mr. Harris?
Present.
Ms. Huff? Ms. Hyman?
Present.
Mr. Kinchin?
Present.
Mr. Miller?
Present.
Mr. Van?
Present.
Mr. Whitley?
Present.
Ms. Winders?
Present.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Okay, are there any adjustments to the agenda?
Yes, good evening. Grace Smith with the Planning Department. We have one adjustment to the agenda that you're already aware of that I emailed out to you previously. The cases for North Roxborough Retail A15-0002 and Z15-00006. The neighbors, or the not the applicant, but the actual neighbors of the request, requested a deferral. So we'll see that on the agenda next month.
Okay.
And I can affirm that all notices have been legal requirements have been advertised per the ordinance and state statute for all the cases on the agenda.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And under new business, can we add announcements? Can I get a motion that the agenda be adopted as modified?
I'd like to make a motion that the agenda be adopted as modified.
Okay. Motion and second that the agenda be adopted as modified. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All those in opposition? Motion carries unanimous. Okay. The approval of the April 12th minutes, there was one correction. Mr. Bryant, would you like to state that correction?
Under the roll call, the fourth name down, I think it should be Charles Gibbs rather than George Gibbs.
Yes.
Noted.
Okay. All right. If there's no other corrections, what's your pleasure?
Motion to approve agenda with corrections.
Second.
I meant minutes with corrections.
Okay. It's been motioned that we approve the minutes as corrected.
And yes, could you please add your motion and in addition the consistency statements that were included. I'm tongue-tied. So the consistency statements.
Motion to approve the minutes as corrected along with consistency statements.
Second.
Okay, you heard the motion. Are you ready to vote? All those in favor, please raise the right hand. Are those in opposition?
The motion is unanimous.
Okay, thank you. The next is a public hearing. Plan amendment with concurrent zoning map change, and this is Shannon Road Retail And I just state before you start, at the conclusion of any of our zoning cases, I'm going to give the commissioners a couple of minutes to write down their comments, so we don't have to try to rush to do it while the thing is going on. And we don't have to try to take them home to write them down, so we can do it while we're here. Staff?
Good evening. Obviously, the staff report lists Amy Wolf as your contact person. I am filling in for the recently departed Ms. Wolf. I am Laura Woods of the Planning Department. And this is Shannon Road Retail, A1500022. The applicant is Robert T. and Theta D. Ghanem, and the jurisdiction is the city. The request is to change the future land use map from medium density residential to commercial, and the site is approximately 1.9 acres. The site is located on the west side of Shannon Road, just south of the intersection of Shannon Road with University Drive. We will be reviewing this against four criteria. The first criteria, criteria A, whether the proposed use is consistent with the intent, goals, objectives, policies, guiding principles, and programs of adopted plans. Criteria B, whether the proposed change would be compatible with the existing land use pattern and or designated future land uses. I feel like I'm a little loud. I hope. It's good. Sir, good. Very good. Criteria C, whether the proposed change would create substantial adverse impact in the adjacent area or in the city or county. And criteria D, whether the subject site is of adequate shape and size to accommodate the proposed change. These are the policies that we found to be applicable to this case. We can discuss them in detail if you wish. There are a couple that I'm going to focus on as I proceed through the presentation. As you see, most of them have to do with Chapter 2 of the Comprehensive Plan, which is your land use chapter. Now, in terms of context, to the north is an existing commercial node. It's mostly commercial. And to the east, northeast, it's a mix of commercial, office, and multifamily uses. To the south, it's primarily multifamily residential. Okay, criteria A was consistency. And staff found that the proposed change would not be consistent with the intent, goals, objectives, policies, and guiding principles of adopted plans. Specifically, policy 2.4.1E of the comprehensive plan. And that policy is provided for you. Indicated in red is perhaps the more significant portion of the text of that policy. Existing suburban transit areas shall be redesignated to the compact neighborhood tier as the locations of transit stations are established. The transit station nearby at South Square, in the South Square area, has been established, ergo, we shall be redesignating the area as compact neighborhood tier. Related to that and working hand in hand with that policy is policy 2.2.4B, compact neighborhood tier land uses, which requires us to utilize design districts for all compact neighborhoods. And as you may know, there is a proposal that will be heard before City Council early in June concerning designation of a compact neighborhood tier and a design district. Now, criteria B is compatibility, and the proposed change would be compatible with the existing land use pattern, but it would not be compatible with a proposed development tier change and designation of a design district, as I previously alluded. Criteria C, substantial adverse impacts. We find that the proposed future land use designation would allow for similar development to the properties already developed in the area. As I say, it is adjacent to an existing commercial node, And criteria D, is it of adequate shape and size to accommodate the proposed use? And yes, it is. Overall, however, staff's recommendation is denial based on consideration of adopted plans and compatibility. And that concludes the staff report for the plan amendment. We will now consider the zoning case. Okay, as I mentioned, the applicant is Robert T. and Theta D. Gonham. The jurisdiction is city, and the zoning request is from residential suburban multifamily to commercial neighborhood with a development plan. And as I mentioned, the acreage is approximately 1.9 acres. The proposed use is a 9,500 square foot floor area commercial use. And in terms of context, we previously mentioned it's near the intersection of Shannon Road and University Drive. And it's a mix of zoning categories. And to the north is mostly commercial with a few office designations. To the east and south is primarily multifamily residential. Now then, zoning standards for neighborhood commercial. Minimum side area is 5,000 square feet. Obviously, they meet that. They meet each of these categories. We can discuss them more fully if you wish. And the existing conditions are there are two single family homes with associated outbuildings. And there's not much to say about it. They're mixed hardwoods with some specimen trees on the site. Those obviously would be removed if this zoning was approved. And the proposed conditions, there shows the building envelope with a buffer of that meets our UDO standards with a potential reduction from 30 feet to 22.5 feet if a wall or berm is provided. The applicant has proffered this summary of commitments, maximum square foot of 9,500 feet for the building, one vehicular access point and one pedestrian site access point, impervious surface of 70%, tree coverage of 15%, and a location of site access points, location of tree replacement areas, and the building and parking envelope, all indicated on the development plan. Summary of text commitments, retail uses shall not exceed 9,500 square feet. No gasoline sales would be permitted. Construction of a northbound left turn lane on Shannon Road at the site access. 4 feet of additional asphalt along Shannon Road for provision of a bicycle lane. A dedication of 5 feet of additional right-of-way on Shannon Road, and the development plan would be, the development would be built in one phase with a dedication of a 5 feet right-of-way, construction of the 9,500 foot building and the associated road improvements on Shannon Road. Here, again, is the future land use. The site is medium density residential. And as I mentioned previously, the applicant would like to change that to a commercial designation. Okay, these are plume policies that are applicable. And some of these you saw in the previous report. Our concern is with consistency with the policies regarding future land use. We found the application not to be consistent. Therefore, staff determines that this request does not meet UDO standards for transit-supported development, something that is associated with compact neighborhoods and design districts. And at build-out, would it be consistent with the future land use map and policies of the Durham Comprehensive Plan and other adopted plans and ordinances? That concludes my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Could someone bring me the sheet up? Thank you. Okay, this is a public hearing. We have one person signed up to speak, and he's for it. So, Jared Eaton.
Good evening. Jared Eaton's with Eaton's Land. I would like to start out, I would like to request a 30-day continuance of both these cases. I've been working with staff recently. I've got a couple ideas about how to improve our application. To maybe be more in line with what the city has planned for this area. So if you would allow that, I would like a 30-day continuance to next month's meeting.
Does the staff, does it have to be 60 days?
No, you can you can continue up to 90 days, but you have a three-cycle limit. You can do 30 days.
Okay, you don't have an objection?
We do not.
Commissioners?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we continue the matter for 30 days.
Second.
Or till our next meeting.
Second.
It's been motion and second that the Shannon Road retail A1500022 and zoning case 1500036 be continued until our next meeting. All those in favor, let it be known by saying aye. I'm sorry. Opposes? Okay, so it's unanimous. Thank you. The next public hearing is zoning map change, and I open the public hearing for 4830 Hope Valley Road, Z150016.
Good evening, Kyle Taylor with the Durham City County Planning Department. And I will be presenting zoning case Z150016, 4830 Hope Valley Road. The applicant for this application is Ben Burkhart with BKB Properties. This property is located within the city's jurisdiction. The request is to go from CN to CG, commercial neighborhood to commercial general with a development plan. The acreage of the site is 1.34 acres, and the proposed use is climate-controlled personal storage. This property is located in the suburban tier at the intersection of Hope Valley and Garrett Road. And as you can see, there is an assortment of the zonings in this area. However, most of them are commercial. This slide outlines just the general requirements of the CG zoning district. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Existing conditions show that this site is actually currently developed as a gas station, and there are a few existing trees, and those are outlined on here as well. Proposed conditions gives the general location of tree preservation areas, building and parking envelopes, and also the building, the project boundary buffer, and two locations of general site access points. The request initially was submitted that they would only have 20,000 square feet of building floor area. However, we have been informed that it was originally meant to meet mean floor area, I mean not floor area, building footprints, and the applicant has requested that we note that this project would be going up. What they'd actually like to ask for is 100,000 square feet. The planning staff has received the revised development plan to that aspect. Two side access points are also identified on this project. Impervious surface maximum is indicated as 59% or 34,000 square feet. Tree coverage is 14% or 8,200 square feet. I mean acres, square feet.
Before you leave this slide.
Yes, sir.
The maximum floor area from 20,000 square feet to 100,000 square feet?
Yes, sir.
Five times bigger. Okay.
They're requesting a multi-story building.
It's vertical, not horizontal construction, so it's we had to have the total square footage is five stories.
Okay.
So the 20,000 square feet is
That's correct.
Thank you.
Graphically, this site gives the general location of site access points, tree preservation replacement areas, building and parking envelope, and the size and location of project boundary buffers. The developer does have one text commitment. This commitment is the commitment to use. He states that the committed use shall be self-service storage or convenience store with gasoline sales. This project is in the commercial future land use and therefore is consistent with future land use map. These are the adopted policies that we looked at while reviewing this application. There is one policy on here that this application is not consistent with, which is the transportation level of service, which requires that the planning staff recommend denial on anything that exceeds 120%, which we'll get into in a minute. So as such, the staff determination is that this request is consistent with future land use map and ordinances, but is not consistent with comprehensive policy 812H that requires the planning department to recommend denial of any zoning case which would result in the average daily trips exceeding 120% of the adjacent roadway capacity. Thank you.
Thank you, Cal. Can I get this sheet?
Excuse me, I have one thing to add. It's actually, if it exceeds 110%, and if they exceed 120, they're exempt from being able to apply mitigation of traffic impacts to get it to 110. So it's actually, it's 110, not 120% is what we're looking at. But okay. Kyle was correct, and it exceeds 120 actually as well, so.
Can I get the sheet? Where is Heyman when you need them? Okay, I have one person sign up to speak, Ben Berhart, in favor of it.
Good evening. Good evening, folks. I'm Ben Burkhart. I'm actually representing the owner of the property here, Stallings Oil. I have a couple things that I want to address pursuant to the staff report that you just heard. Number one, just to clarify the 20,000.
Susan, start the timer.
Excuse me?
I was talking to Susan.
Oh, okay. I might need a little help getting this to work. I thought that it would just come right on. Number one, just to clarify the 20,000 square feet versus 100,000 square feet, I saw a couple of you sit back in your seat. From the very first moment that we walked in to consult with staff on this project, we were always proposing a multi-story building. We were instructed along the way, and we were passed between a couple planners to word it at 20,000 square feet as the footprint. So just to clarify, this is what we walked into the office with. This is the building that we proposed on this property. This is a rendering of the type of building that we're considering building, that we'd like to get the rezoning for. The second thing that I'd like to address is the traffic impact. Presently, this property is what we would consider sort of an antiquated convenience store gas station. I mean, it's been there for 30 years or so, 40 years. I think there's 8 pumps there. And what Bill Judge from the planning department has told us is that the existing use generates about 1,300 trips per day. And I see in the staff report that the justification for recommending denial is that the adjacent roadways are at 120% capacity, and so they have to recommend denial. However, this new use, even per Bill Judge's calculations, dramatically decreases the traffic impact on this site. So what you have is a small intersection that's relatively congested, and you have a high traffic impact on this small parcel. What we're proposing is to build something like this, aesthetically pleasing, nice curb appeal, and it's a quiet use. Bill Judge's calculations were that this use, as proposed, 100,000 square feet, would generate a maximum of 250 trips per day. The existing use generates about 1,300 or 1,400 trips per day. So while your staff report states that the justification for recommending denial is that it is based almost strictly on traffic impact, this use that we're proposing dramatically decreases the traffic impact on this site. The third thing that I'd like to address is that we've had a tenant in this property. And so during our planning process, we did not want to, with a rezoning request, impact the tenant's ability to operate their business. We have just this week amended, sort of at the last minute, our proffer that this would not be climate-controlled storage or convenience store with gas station or gas sales, but that it would only be climate-controlled storage. So what you're seeing up on the screen, that's what we want to build on this property. Very high-end, very aesthetically pleasing. We've determined that there's a very high demand for storage in this area. We think that this parcel suits. We think that it fits well in the neighborhood. It decreases the traffic impact. And you know, it's a nice property. So certainly would like to have your support on it. I'd be happy to answer any questions or.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Is there anyone else from the audience who'd like to speak to this item?
Yeah, staff would just like two clarifications from the developer. One is he actually committing to removing the use of the gas station from that, which is that's what the number for the traffic calculations in the staff report are based on, because at the time it was a commitment. So the first one is he removing that as one of the committed uses and just leaving it as self-storage? And the second one is the proposed graphic that he's showing currently, is that actually going to be considered a commitment as well?
Two questions. Number one was, are we deleting convenience store with gas sales from the proposed use? The answer is yes. Second question, is the picture that we have up on the screen offered as a commitment? This has been sort of an issue of debate with staff since we first walked in the door, because this is what we intend to build. Now, the placement of the windows or the placement of the pillars or the exact access not being shown on that particular rendering, I don't know that we're at the point where we can commit exactly to what you see, but what we do have is This is an actual building in Raleigh, not too far from here, about a half hour from here, that we just built, we just opened up. This is the look that we're going for. So if we have to make a commitment based on the rendering that I showed you here, certainly I think that we can in spirit. The particulars, the staff has advised us against that because of the particulars that are maybe not clearly defined. I sort of want to lead with my best foot forward here. I mean, this is a nice, attractive building. And that's what we're going for. That's what we build. That's what we want to build. So maybe that was a roundaway.
Wait a minute. I need to close the public hearing before I bring it back to us.
I'm sorry.
Okay. And now I was talking to Commissioner Brown. Okay. Thank you. Is there anyone else in the audience who'd like to speak to this? Any public? Okay, I will close the public hearing and bring it back before the commissioners. Do I have commissioners with questions? And I have, okay, wait a minute. Let me just find my notepad. Okay. Where is he? Okay, Gooch, George, Melvin, as I call your name, you put your hand down. Anybody else over here? Okay, Bugsby, Miller, you want to speak? Okay, Miller, Went, Rebecca, anybody else on the left? George Gibbs. Okay, the first speaker is Commissioner Gooch.
I've got a question for staff. I guess, is Bill over there? I think I see Bill. Yeah. There he is. So I realized in our staff report, the traffic numbers are based off of a gas station and convenience store. And that has just been removed as a allowable use. And I'm not asking you to commit to a number, but I am asking, generally speaking, I mean, I've never seen one of these self-storage places, like, you know, packed with cars or anything. What do you know what kind of traffic we're talking about at that point?
Yes, Bill Judge with Transportation. We did have some conversations with the applicant in advance of the hearing and anticipated that they were going to potentially make that proffer to limit it to self-storage. So I was able to prepare the numbers in advance. 100,000 square foot self-storage facility would generate 250 trips per day.
Okay.
And as in the staff report, the existing use generates 1,302 trips per day. So before if we'd had that information in advance, the new would have said 250, which would have been a decrease of 1,052 trips per day.
And would that get us in the 110?
It does not.
It does
even
not,
with the obviously, even with the decrease, it would lower just because the existing capacity is so far over. With the decrease, it would lower it to from 135% LOSD to 131. So it's a decrease, but it doesn't get it down. So it's currently operating at 135. With this change in use, it would decrease that capacity. It would decrease it to operating at 131% of capacity. So.
And I'm curious as to how the staff report works on, you know, when that is the case, because I mean, it's interesting. I don't know that I've seen it before, but it's decreasing traffic, yet not to the standard that we are hoping to achieve. But I mean, would the staff report still recommend denial in that case? I mean, it seems kind of counterintuitive.
I think I'll probably have to defer to the planning department, but I think the wording on the comprehensive plan is very specific. That basically just says anything over 120%, they automatically have to recommend denial. There was some confusion with the 110%.
Yeah, sure.
When it's operating between 110 and 120%, if it's more than a 3% increase, planning has to recommend denial as well. So originally in the staff report, we were looking at the expansion, and it was going to be a 50% increase in trips. So that's why why they had indicated it was 110%. Now with this additional proffer, that threshold moves to 120 since it's a decrease in traffic, but it's still over the 120.
Grace Smith, Planning Department. The staff will not be able to change our recommendation based on how the policy is written. It's very strict and straightforward in that regard.
Okay.
Even though we do understand the applicant's position and what they're trying to achieve here, but we're not able to change our recommendation.
So. Sure. And if I could ask the applicant then, I'm curious as to what you, I assume you had a neighborhood meeting, that kind of thing. I don't know what the property owners are like around there. Have you gotten any feedback outside of the planning staff about traffic and you know, the fact that you would be reducing traffic here? Do you know how that's been received by surrounding property owners, that type of thing?
We did not have to have a neighborhood meeting on this.
Okay.
And just to clarify, the roads are already over capacity.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we're sort of, nothing that we would propose there would gain a
support,
recommendation,
yeah.
Even if we planted trees there, that with no traffic. I mean,
maybe so, if you built like a whole new lane there, like, you know, the entire property, a new lane. I'm joking, of course. I understand. I mean, the roads are already over capacity, and any redevelopment, whether it's less intense use, as is the case here, or more intense use, just wouldn't get the support from staff based off of how the comprehensive plan is written, which I think is a little bit odd. I mean, at some rate, we should.
If we have a congested intersection and we're lowering the impact of a parcel,
that sounds good to me. That's all I really had to ask. But I appreciate the answer. Thank you. And thank you, staff.
Commissioner Bryant.
I guess my concern, since we seem to be hearing a proposal which is quite different from what we got in our staff report and which we got in our development plan that was attached, I'm going to just come out and say I'm uncomfortable making a decision one way or the other until I see this proposal that's been presented tonight. You know, I heard mention of a new development plan. I think we need to see a report that reflects what we've been told tonight. And that's all.
Commissioner Whitley.
I certainly concur with my fellow Commissioner Bryant on this. I have a problem anytime someone comes to develop anything in a residential neighborhood or close to a residential neighborhood that don't have a neighborhood meeting about it or give opportunity for the neighborhood to respond. I, for one, as a commissioner, I want to hear what the neighborhood thinks about anything being built in their neighborhood. And they don't think enough to come out and express that. Then
keep going. You got 2 minutes, 14 seconds.
If they don't come out and express that, then I might give some way. But not giving them the opportunity, I strongly recommend that this be postponed. This be postponed for 30 days, so we can see the original document. I mean, the development. And that, and a strong suggestion that you meet with the neighborhood.
Commissioner, but you through?
Yeah, I'm finished.
Commissioner Bugsby.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Along the same lines as Commissioner Whitley, I had just a question for staff. If you could explain why there wasn't a requirement for a public hearing, and then I'm wondering if this was, a neighborhood meeting, and then if this had come forward just specifically to go from a convenience store to a self-service station, would that have changed any requirements?
Okay, so the first question you asked was why there was not a neighborhood meeting requirement, and that is because there was not a TIA required, and this is not also this case is not related to a plan amendment. So the applicant was not required to have a neighborhood meeting. So as far as I don't believe it would have. There's, I don't believe there's any use that could be proposed. I mean, without us doing the research and writing the staff report, obviously, that would reduce the numbers enough to make the transportation issue work out at this point. So.
And then just an additional question. Any remediation issues that need to be mentioned here? If we are guaranteed to be moving from a convenience store or a gas station that's been in place for 30, 40 years, when I was reading this before, I was wondering about that, but thinking, well, there's a good chance this will just become a gas station with 12 pumps. Now we're hearing it's guaranteed to move from a gas station with 8 pumps to a storage unit, definitively, if this moves forward. Any issues that need to be flagged?
If they commit to that on their revised D plan, then that would be a use commitment as part of their development plan. They certainly can do that. I did want to add, though, earlier that we were talking about the graphic depictions, and one of the reasons that staff advises applicants not to bring graphics to the hearing is because there's a section in the ordinance that specifically states that graphic depictions other than those listed above shall not be shown at, submitted at, or otherwise used in connection with any public hearing on a zoning map change with a development plan unless they depict only the area within the scope of the development plan and our development plan commitments in their entirety. Such graphic depictions shall supersede existing commitments, if any, and there if any conflicts exist, to the extent they are more stringent. So basically, anything that's proposed here, a graphic, is committed at that point. Of course, we can work with the applicant if they're going to submit a revised development plan, or if something happens and the case is continued, we can work with them in that respect as well.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Commissioner?
Yes, I think I agree with, thank you. I agree with Commissioner Brine. We don't really know what we're looking at, but I did have an additional question. I'm very familiar with this particular area, and it is highly congested. So one of the questions that I had would, even though you're reducing the number of trips, would there be additional access points to get to this facility that would perhaps reduce the amount of traffic that's going in any particular at any particular time?
I believe the answer is no. I think we would be using the same access points to the property. Right now there are two access points and we would just be folding into the same access points.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you.
Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I have a question of staff about what parking would be required for a 100,000 square foot self-storage facility.
That's technically a site plan question. We would have to look that up and get back with you in a few minutes. Those types of site plan improvements are viewed as site plan. So.
I realize
the envelope
that, but,
and the building
and
envelope
and
is on the D plan. So.
I normally wouldn't ask, but
yeah.
So we've got a one.
I mean, I can tell you. I'm just going to have to look it up.
Okay.
Yeah, it just will take a minute. Is there something else you needed in the meantime?
Well, the point I was going mm-hmm. to make is this is a 1.34 acre site, and I've just kind of eyeballed the development plan, and it looks like we're using a big, the actual building envelope is probably somewhere maybe generously a little bit more than half of the total mm-hmm. square footage. Mm-hmm. And so subtract out of that 20,000 square feet for the footprint. And now all of a sudden I am down to about 50,000 square feet for traffic circulation and parking. And I'm having a little trouble seeing how this can actually be as big as the 100,000 square feet unless there is a minimal parking requirement.
Right, so this parking requirement is based on the number of units, so it's one per 100 units.
Mm-hmm.
It's not based on square footage.
Right.
Unless we knew the number of units, I couldn't tell you that. And that's something, again, that may would probably be come up at site plan approval.
I'm just having a hard time making all of it fit on the piece of property. Maybe the developer can help me to understand, because you've certainly been playing with the calculus here. Because I'm getting about 70,000 square feet of usable space, and that's generous, because this property's got actually a fairly steep slope on one side of it that you're not going to be able to change much without a retaining wall. And so we get down to 20,000 square feet for your building footprint, and that leaves about 50,000 square feet for everything else. And that's not a lot of space unless you're not going to park very many cars.
Well,
do you really think you can get 100,000 square feet on there?
Oh, absolutely. With a 20,000 square foot footprint, five stories tall.
Well, I realize that you can build it. The question is, can you make it all fit when you add all the requirements in that come with that?
Absolutely, and we've been through this with planning over several months of what type of building envelope would suit what we're trying to build. On the parking requirements, you know, we'd probably have somewhere in the neighborhood of 700 units here. So we would have a parking requirement of seven spaces. And if you go by any self-storage in the whole area, you would rarely see
when
two
you say
or
seven
three
spaces,
cars.
You seven parking spaces?
Seven parking spaces.
So it's one parking space per 100?
That's the requirement. That's the requirement.
That's what I wanted to know.
And if we didn't have a requirement, we would have six parking spaces. Right. I mean, six would
well,
be
that
sort
helps.
Of our
that,
maximum.
That helps me understand. Yeah. That's what I wanted to know. Thanks.
Mr. Miller, that's what I had stated. This wasn't based on square footage. It's based on number of units. And sure. It's one per 100, but he has not committed to a number of units, so we weren't sure.
Right. I was just trying to guess at how tiny the parking requirement for one of these had to be.
That's correct.
And now I understand. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Commissioner Winders.
Well, I too am very familiar with this property. And I also agree that considering the changes in the proposal that for your sake as well as ours, we should defer it for until you can work through everything. And as far as the neighborhood meeting, there are not very many, if there are hardly any residential families that live around there, but right behind it is a church that might well be impacted by having a five-story building in front of them, you know, even as far as, what it's going to do to the light and everything, you know. And there's also kind of a strange driveway or access to the church. And it's they have lots of classes there all week long that community people come to, and they've got a playground that is open to the public sun up to or whenever anybody gets up to open the gate until sundown, I think. And you know, it's really a community resource that we don't want to, and you definitely need to explain to them what is going to happen and or what your plans are. And I would really like to hear from them at the public hearing. And then there's Jordan High School right next to that, which I guess wouldn't be impacted by this too much, but you know, it wouldn't be a bad idea to check them out too.
The students would be. They wouldn't have any place to go.
To get there, they wouldn't have
any. Okay, all comments to the chair.
Okay. So that was, thank you.
Commissioner Kitchen.
Yeah, I'm a little bit conflicted on this as well. I think, first of all, the idea of removing 1,000 cars excites me. My daughter goes to Jordan, and I've made that trip. I'm more familiar with that area than any other spot probably on earth. It's very congested. I think primarily though it's between the hours of 6:45 and 7:30, 10:30 to 1, and 2:15 to 3. Other times it's not that much congestion. And it excites me to remove that because it's a very dangerous intersection and the kids in and out of the gas station all the time, cars. So that excites me to remove that kind of traffic from that intersection. I would want to hear from the church though. I think Commissioner Winders makes a great point. They will be impacted. So I think if you could defer and speak with them and see what kind of impact it'll have on them would be helpful for me.
Commissioner Gibbs.
Well, everything that's been said so far, I agree with, I disagree with, I agree with, but it just comes down to, and I appreciate all the comments, it, even if building this maintains status quo of the traffic, and I understand it will lower it some, it would be a nice addition and a good change over having the gas station and the convenience store there, but it does impact the neighborhood. And I've never seen a five-story storage space. If it gets built, I will be certain to go by and see what it's like. But at this point, it's and I'm just saying this to agree with everybody. If I had to make a decision tonight, I still don't know which way I would go. But it's not. I would follow the advice of staff. But that's all my comments, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Are there any other comments?
We're happy to defer for, I don't know how long it will take us. I don't know if we can organize the neighborhood meeting in 30 days or 60 days. Probably 60 days is what I need. So I'll request that this be deferred for 60 days, and I'll personally go and talk with whoever it is at the church, trustees or the deacons or the pastor or everybody, because I hear your comments, and whatever we build, we want it to be an addition to the community, not a detractor. Our operating assumption here, which may have been misplaced, was that a nice, attractive building next to the church that is a very quiet use with limited or no access in the evenings is a much better neighbor to the community there than a gas, you know, an old kind of rundown gas station. But certainly we're happy to defer for 60 days. Whatever we do, we want to do it the right way.
Okay, we will continue for 60 days. So right. Brian or Joe or
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would move that the Planning Commission reopen the public hearing on this and continue it until our meeting in July.
Second.
It's been motioned and second that zoning case 15-00164830 Hope Valley Road be continued for two cycles. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All those in opposition, it's unanimous. Okay. Now we will open the public hearing on 3233 North Carolina 55 Highway Z150017.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. This project is also by Ben Burkhart with BKB Properties. This property is also in the city. The request for this one is to go from commercial neighborhood with a development plan to commercial general with a development plan. The site acreage for this property is 2.35 acres, and the request is for climate-controlled personal storage. This property is located within the suburban tier at the intersection of North Carolina Highway 55 and East Cornwallis Road. This slide gives a general overview of the requirements for the CG zoning district. If you have any questions about these requirements, please let me know. This gives a general overview of the existing conditions from this site. As you can see, this is currently also developed as a gas station, and there is a little bit of slope variation in the back of this property. This property, this is the proposed conditions page. It gives the general location of the tree preservation areas, the building envelope, and project boundary buffers, as well as the two existing site access points that the developer wishes to maintain, with the exception of one being moved a little bit. The intensity for this site is 35,000 square feet, but again, this is the building footprint that was indicated. It's actually 105,000 square feet for this one. There are the two existing site access points and that are shown on this as being access points. The impervious surface for this is 69% or 70,000 square feet, and tree coverage is 10% or 10,237 square feet. Graphically, the developer commits to location of site access points, location of tree preservation areas, building and parking envelope, and size and location of project boundary buffers. Developer does have several text commitments along with this project, including widening the section of Cornwallis Road, dedicating an additional four feet of asphalt to provide for a bike lane, and also to shift the existing access point for Cornwallis Road, and to maintain with the city and state standards as far as his roadway improvements go. And he does also commit on this project to the uses of self-storage and convenience store with gasoline sales. This project is also located in the future land use designation of commercial and is consistent with the future land use plan. These are the sections of the comprehensive plan that we looked at in relation to this project, and it does meet these standards. Staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan policies and ordinances. Thank you. I'm available for any questions.
All right. Thank you, Cal. I have one person signed up to speak, and that's Ben Burkhart.
This is almost the same thing. Again, the point of clarity is the advisement from staff was that the 35,000 footprint should be worded as such. The intention has always been to build something. Something like this. And again, I'm not committing to this design does not it doesn't bother me, because this is what we want to build. This is what we've designed to this point. So if there are questions about what we're proposing, I would I'd be happy to entertain them. But again, same thing here. The commitment would be for self-storage, not self-storage with gasoline sales.
All right, thank you. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak to this item? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and bring it back before the commissioners. Do I have commissioners wishing to speak to this item? We'll go this way first. Okay, I have Bugsby and Brian. Okay, Bugsby.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a simple question. Again, I just want to be clear for all of us. The picture you put up, that is not a committed element, right? From, I don't know if this is, yeah. Is this one a committed element?
It is a committed graphic at this point. That's the text I was reading to you all ago out of the ordinance.
I just want to be clear. Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Bryan.
So, again, this is one where the calculation of traffic in the staff report was based on a gasoline and convenience store, and that is, are you removing that commitment? So this will be, what, 70,000 feet of storage, 35,000 foot, and two stories? 105. Okay. And I have a question for Bill Judge, please. If I understand correctly, you have recommended that the access on the NC 55 be a right in, right out?
Correct.
How will you enforce that movement?
I believe there's already an existing median there, so the access on 55 is already right in, right out on that portion.
There is. So, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And Commissioner Gush.
Sorry, Bill, before you sit down, I almost got there.
Yeah.
I had the same question about traffic counts. I don't know if you had a chance to update the numbers, but just so we know what they were. I mean, in this case, it was already recommended for approval, but I think it's nice to know.
Yeah, I did not for this case, although I think he just said 105,000, so it's about 5% more than the other. So, I mean, the other one was going to be 250, so you're probably looking at about 275 trips per day.
Sure, that's
with that commitment.
That works.
So,
do you know roughly how many units there would be? I mean, roughly. I'm not asking for a commitment. Okay, so same kind of parking scenario. Those are really all the questions I have. Thanks.
Okay. Commissioner Miller.
Mr. Chairman, if it's the appropriate time, I move that.
I have two other
comments. Oh, I'm sorry.
Comments.
Forgive me.
Commissioner Gibbs.
I have just, if you'll clarify in my mind, there will be two entrances, one from 55 and one from Cornwallis. Is that true? Okay, when the question was about a right in and a right out on 55, I thought, well, that's going to be rather restricted, but that's my question. Thank you.
Commissioner Bugsby.
Great, thank you. Just an editorial comment. I think this is, from my perspective, I think this is a fine proposal. If it meets the recommendations, I'm planning to support it. I will just say editorially, there has to be a better way for us to get information in advance, especially for the staff on the fly to have to be figuring out numbers and getting us information. So just wanted to say that. I understand things are changing as we move through the process, but it certainly is difficult for us to make good, sound decisions, especially when the staff already had to put a lot of work into doing analysis that does change. I know things change, but I would hope in the future we would get the information we would need in advance, if possible. But I do plan to support this.
Commissioner Freeman.
I just want to say thank you, Mr. Busby, for that comment. And we did work with the applicant as much as we could in advance of the meeting, and he was advised he would have to proffer these changes at the meeting because the time had passed for us to update the staff reports. So, but thank you for that, and we'll be sure if when the other one comes back, maybe we'll be in a better shape. So.
Commissioner Freeman.
I just wanted to also echo in Commissioner Bugsby's comments that similarly to the previous case, there are residents that do live near here, and they're also not going to get this updated information that we're getting tonight. I also think this is I think it's a great location. I think I'm cautioned on the fact that you didn't hold a neighborhood meeting, and there are changes being made, and how much does the people or the residents or commercial, whoever are the folks that are in this community, how much do they know is happening right now? So I just want to, just a word of caution and moving forward right now with all these changes, that's all.
So, you know, Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm a little troubled by this. So with this project, we have changed the square footage. We have changed commitment as to use. We've added commitment as to building elevation, but or at least some design commitments with regard to building design, which are a little fuzzy and amorphous. I heard him say that there would be three stories, and we need to change the staff report. And for that reason, Mr. Chairman and members of the commission, I move that we continue this to our July meeting so that we can vote on and send forward zoning case to the city council that everybody can understand, they know what they're voting on. I think that's an important thing to do. I don't even know how I would write my comments on this without being sure, especially with regard to the building elevation or the design commitments that were proffered. I'm a big believer in those, by the way, and have worked with developers to create them. This is a little fuzzy, though. I would like to have a chance to get it just right so that we're not still doing planning when this case comes in front of the city council.
Was that a motion?
That's a motion.
I have a motion on the floor.
Second.
Commissioner.
Yes, I guess I have to submit an alternative motion. Well, I don't know. Bill, will you come back? Would you allow me to colloquy with him?
Ben.
Hmm?
Ben, not Bill.
Ben.
He can hear you.
I strongly, if there's not a neighborhood meeting involved in this, I'm not going to vote against it. I mean, I'm not going to vote for it. You know, I just think anytime we're developing something in a neighborhood or near a neighborhood, there needs to be a neighborhood meeting. You know, if nobody shows up, if one person show up, you know, we would have heard from the community where you built. You know, I just don't vote for things unless I have that community input. 30 days, what is it, 30 days you recommend?
He said two cycles.
Two cycles. That's committal that you will have a neighborhood meeting?
Yes.
Yes, I'm ready, Mr. Chairman.
There's been motion, Commissioner Brown.
A quick question for staff, and I know you may not be able to answer it, but given that the notification distance for zoning cases is 600 feet, do we have any established neighborhoods within that distance?
So, Mr. Brown, I don't have I can't tell you what the exact, definitive answer there, but there's definitely, within 600 feet, looks like there's some residential units. I can't tell you how many, but there are some within 600
Thank
feet.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, it's a motion by Commissioner Miller, second by Commissioner Freeman, that this be continued for two cycles. You have an unreadiness? Okay.
Just noting that there is the Partners Against Crime for District 4 noted as one of the recipients of the notification. I would definitely reach out to them, just so you're aware.
Okay. So all in favor of the two-cycle continuance, please raise your right hand. All those in opposition?
The motion carries 12 to 1.
Mr. Chair, before we open the next public hearing, I'd like to ask that I be recused for Murphy USA. Thank you.
That's no problem. No problem. Okay, can I get a motion that Commissioner Gooch be recused?
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second that Commissioner Gooch be recused from this public hearing. All those in favor, but let it be known by showing the right hand. All those in opposition?
So,
it carried. 12 to nothing. All right, Anybody need a minute to complete their comments? I see Commissioner Gibbs writing. Okay, the chair will now open the public hearing on Murphy USA Z15-0035.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. This is zoning case Z15-00035, Murphy, USA. The applicant for this project is Greg Sistrunk with Greenbow Faro. It is within the city's jurisdiction. The request is to go from commercial general with a development plan to commercial general with a development plan. This is a modification of an existing development plan. The site acreage for the site area being modified is 0.82 acres, but is part of a larger development plan as a whole. The proposed use in this case is a gas station with convenience stores located within the existing parking lot of Walmart. This is the context area for this. The parcel is Walmart, currently developed as Walmart, and the section that they're actually going to be modifying is a small section of their parking lot. These are the requirements for the CG zoning district. If you have any questions about them, please let me know. This is the existing conditions page for the project. As you can see in the shaded area, they do have existing park and ride located on this site that they will need to move. This is the proposed conditions page. The developer does show the proposed building and parking envelope for this project. The developer commits to 7,000 square feet of building floor area. Impervious surface maximum will not exceed 80%. This does exceed the district requirement of the FJB zoning district, however, is a subsect of a larger project, which is what the calculation is based on, and will not exceed the originally approved of larger plan of 60%. Their tree coverage and buffer project boundary buffers were met was Z050040 for this project, and the building and envelope, building and parking envelope are shown graphically. There is one text commitment for this, which is subject to termination by Go Durham and Go Triangle on the need to for a transit-related improvements at the time of site plan submittal, construct a concrete pad for a bus shelter, and install a bus shelter if provided by the Go Triangle or Go Durham with a dedicated public transit easement. This project is located within the commercial designation of the future land use map and therefore is consistent with the future land use map. These are the policies that we looked at from the comprehensive plan when evaluating this project. And staff does determine that this request is consistent with comprehensive plan and other adopted policies and ordinances. If you have any questions, I'm available. Thank you.
Thank you, Cal.
We have one person signed up to speak. Vinnie, I can't pronounce your last name. Okay.
Usually I just respond. If it starts with an S, I just say yes, that's me. good evening, members of the commission. My name is Jamie Schwadler with Parker Poe. Address is 150 Fayetteville Street in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'd like to start by saying that we represent the applicant here. Mr. Greg Sistrunk is also in the audience and available to answer any technical questions should the commission have those, but I'll be covering what Kyle went over in a staff review and then have a presentation for some of the pictures that give you a better feel of the site. If you'll bear with me just 1 minute.
So
I know this might go without saying, but I just am cautioning again on the use of graphics, that they are committed once you present them. So I just wanted to make sure.
I appreciate that. And these are just site photographs.
That's fine. Just, okay. Just making sure. Just
no, and thank
for
you.
For everyone's edification.
Okay. And thank you for that clarification. I'd also like to take this time to thank staff for working with us through this project. We went through some technical discussions, and they've been very helpful, and we appreciate their patience in working with us on that. We think we've got a project that now meets the requirements, and we're grateful for staff's revisions and determination that we meet the code requirements and recommend them for approval. As Kyle mentioned, this is 0.82 acres, excuse me, within an overall approved development plan. So we're changing it from commercial to commercial. It's just this very small portion of the site is going to transfer from a Walmart parking lot to a gas station with a convenience store and the bays for fuel. The land use designation is commercial. We saw earlier that they're going from commercial general with a development plan to another commercial general with a development plan, and I'll address the text commitment in a little bit. The history on this site was a development plan that was approved in 2006 in case number Z0540. That approved development plan designated this area just as a parking lot. And since that time, we've gone forward with our application. We did hold a neighborhood meeting that was very well received. We had two persons who appeared and actually spoke in favor and asked us how soon we would open. There was comments made of, you know, how they drove it quite a distance to get gasoline at the price that they believed would be available here. And so there was a lot of eagerness. And I understand staff received some questions from persons who received notice, just or general kind of what the plans were, what the development would look like and the timing, but not any opposition to our project. And I would like to clarify that the park and ride that's existing there is going to be relocated, not removed completely. That'll be taken care of as we develop. So this is just a bird's eye view, and I appreciate Grace's clarification. This is not any type of commitment, just an overall aerial. The green square in the corner is the area that is existing parking lot and will become the approved gas station if approved. This is a view of the Walmart parking lot looking south, where you see the semis parked is the approximate area. Those first two semis are the approximate area of where we're talking about here. A view to the east, so standing and looking back toward the parcel or the postage stamp in the parking lot, and a view to the southwest. So this would be standing at that existing access lane into the Walmart parking lot, where you'd be looking right toward the building envelope. And we would submit at this point the project meets and satisfies the UDO requirements. We've heard that it's consistent with the district and environmental, traffic, and infrastructure requirements. As you've seen your staff report, it's consistent with the development plan requirements and with the comprehensive plan and adopted policies that are detailed. And I'd like just to highlight some of those. We actually meet or exceed the minimum area and lot width. We meet the district standards for yards and heights. As Kyle mentioned, some of the tree coverage and things were covered in the existing overall plan and are not applicable here. A TIA was performed. It was determined by NCDOT that no roadway improvements would be required as a result of development. It's significant here that unlike the other projects we've seen tonight, because we're in an existing Walmart parking lot with ample infrastructure, access lanes, and traffic flow, that we already have a great deal of infrastructure in place, and that's why I think the NCDOT made the determination that the improvements were not required here. We've also addressed in the development plan the intensity, the building and parking envelopes, the buffers, and I think Kyle went into a good amount there, and I'm happy to answer questions on those things. Tree coverage, again, was not applicable because we meet it within the overall existing approved development plan. We have offered design commitments, and I'll highlight those in just a second, as well as a text commitment for the transit portal. And so this is just the envelope you can see there on your screen. It's just the what we'll call the postage stamp of the overall Walmart parking lot that we'll be affecting. Some of the design commitments, and these are summaries. The actual commitments are listed in the development plan package. But essentially what we're doing is offering design commitments such that the materials we're offering and the roof style and structure that we're offering would match what's already out there. You have an existing commercial node. We're trying to blend in with that as best we can so that we can offer this gas station amenity for the people in this area, but still blend in and fit within that commercial node. So all of the design commitments and materials were designed with that purpose in mind. Again, the staff report highlighted that we're consistent with the comprehensive plan. We're going from commercial to commercial, and we fit within the future land use patterns because it's in that existing commercial code. The comprehensive plan really focused on the infrastructure, the capacity. We're not adding new students. We're not adding a significant change to the traffic pattern. We're working within that existing plan as best that we can. And for those reasons, we'd submit that the plan is consistent with Durham's code, it's consistent with the comprehensive plan, and again, we'd like to thank staff for shepherding us through the project and believe we have something that meets all of the town's requirements, and I'm happy to answer any questions on those.
Thank you. Do we have other members in the audience that wish to speak to this item? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and bring it back before the Planning Commission. Okay. Let's see. Amanda. Where are you? Whitley. Van. Freeman. Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't catch her name.
I think she called
Mindy?
Vinnie.
And anytime I see anything that says 80% impervious surface, it's just an automatic question. So how is the water running off right now? And how's the...
The existing plan allowed for 60% overall. Mm-hmm. And if you look at just this area of the plan, it's actually at 90% because it's just a flat asphalt lot. And so we're actually, this addition brings down the impervious count to closer to 80.
Okay. And then I just want to know if there's any flooding in that area right now.
I don't believe so, but we can hear from Mr. Sistrunk who does handle the engineering portion.
I'm Greg Sistrunk, the applicant, Greenberg Farrow. We're the civil engineer and architect for the project. And the site sits at the one of the higher points on the parking lot, and it flows to the west back towards existing inlets on the parking lot, so there's no flooding issues associated with this part. So.
And is the water flowing like under or underneath the parking lot, or is it just all running off into the...
Right, existing conditions, the water drained surface flows, sheet flows into existing great inlets in the Walmart parking lot.
Okay.
We're going to capture that water and put it underground and connect to a structure in the Walmart parking lot. So it'll make stormwater be conveyed more efficiently.
Thank you.
Commissioner Van.
Yeah, I was just going to note I think this project is a good fit for that area. I'm in that area all the time, live not far from there. And I think it's something that's pretty necessary and doesn't see too much major impact. And I do like the fact that it, like I said, pretty much is already in confined space there, considering the Walmart areas are already there. So I will certainly be voting in favor.
Commissioner Whitley?
Yes. Listen. I doubt if a bus route's gonna come that way. But it is really ridiculous that a structure that has that much income generated have a bus come to it, and when it's raining, they all get wet. Now, it's on the other corner, you know? and it says something about who we are as a city that we can't correct that. And most of the people that catches the bus out there, they have groceries and other things that they buy from that area. And no one cares about how they get home. You know, a bus shelter on the existing one would be a real improvement.
Thank you. And you're speaking about the existing Walmart parking lot overall? Well, I think we can, we might be able to take care of that concern with the text commitment. The way that it's written is that at site plan review, if Go Triangle and Go Durham determines that transit service comes out that way, we've committed to providing the pad for the bus shelter that would be provided provided by Go Triangle, Go Durham, if they determine that service is extended.
Yes, that's the reason why I didn't ask for a commitment. But I am asking you to do something. And if there's no more than talk to Walmart and the businesses there, that's not real. That's not Durham. You know, it's not it gets a lot of traffic, and people get on the bus specifically to go to Walmart. You know, and if it's rain, they get wet. Incoming weather, it's not, you know, I try whenever I'm in the area and it's raining, I try to take as many people as I can to where there's a shelter. But there's something that's called compassion and empathy. Those two words, you know? And a friendly telephone call to whoever can make the decision is the right thing to do. Thank you.
I appreciate those comments.
Commissioner Huff.
BikePad suggested that y'all provide a direct pedestrian connection to this development from the adjacent site. Are you going to do that?
We're going to provide pedestrian access to the sidewalk, the nearest sidewalk on the site, which will lead to the rest of the development. So yes, okay. we're going to provide that.
Commissioner Bryan.
I don't have any objection to where you're putting this, but I am curious as to why you are looking at the Walmart parking lot as a location for this rather than one of the out parcels.
Great question. This site was chosen, as you know, parking requirements 10, 15 years ago were much more. You had to provide a lot more parking spaces, and we've come to look that the parking is just there one day, 2 days of the year, before Thanksgiving, after Thanksgiving, Christmas. So most of the time the parking lot is just a strain on infrastructure, and it goes mostly unused. So with this project, Murphy has chosen to purchase a portion of the parking lot furthest from the building, which circulation-wise works well with the patrons visiting Walmart. It works well with the bus route. So I think it's an efficient design. It's using placing a new use for a use that doesn't get used much as it stands. So,
thank you.
Commissioner Miller.
On that same theme, and while you're at the podium, how many spaces have you got in the parking lot today?
Overall, for the full Glenview station, seems to be it was right over 900, I believe.
And what do you think your average daily demand is, actual use? If you had to guess.
25%, maybe.
And in that week before Christmas, do you ever actually max this parking lot out?
I don't think it's maxed out very often. So, you know, Walmart could probably attest to that. Mm-hmm. But when we're going through these fueling stations with them.
Well, they're obviously willing to give up the parking. How many spaces are implicated in this?
I think it's around 100 spaces, I believe. So, and we
But you're going to put parking spaces back, too.
We are relocating the park and ride spaces that are there currently mm-hmm. To meet the UDO. The parking spaces that were built, more were built than what was required during the original development plan. Mm-hmm. So we're still going to meet the UDO with minimum parking spaces.
And this facility itself will have parking spaces. And it's not facility. All going to be under roof.
No, that's right. This one will have its own dedicated parking spaces to visit the store. And of course, the fueling stations where you dispense fuel, that is considered a parking space in some jurisdictions, but we'll meet code.
Any other comments? If not, the chair will entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, if it's the appropriate time, I move that we send this case forward to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Miller, second by Commissioner Whitley, that we send zoning case 15-00035 to the appropriate elected official with a favorable recommendation. All those in favor, let it be known by showing the right hand. All those in opposition? All right, thank you. Announcements, what's coming up?
So, we're going to have, it looks like we're going to have two plan amendment cases next month and one, two, three, four zoning cases. And in addition to the two, we'll have to add the two that were deferred from this month to next month. So we're going to have a full plate.
Okay.
We'll have both the Roxborough cases. We'll have the East End land use analysis will come in. The Golden Belt Historic District case will be coming in. The East End land use analysis of zoning map change, the evaluation and assessment report will be coming in, the Farrington Place at South Point, which is a zoning case, no plan amendment, Barini Drive assemblage will be coming in. These are tentative, this is what we think you'll be seeing, and a case from Moe's Tavern up in northern part of the county, zoning case. So.
Okay, the other thing we have four yeah. commissioners whose terms is ending next month. Commissioner Bugsby, Commissioner Gibbs, Commissioner Huff, and Commissioner Winders' terms are all ending next month. And then we have one vacancy that's being filled. Do we have any?
So I have not heard of any updates, but I do know that the positions have been advertised. I received a notice to that effect. So.
The city's made appointments.
I did not. Did you get notice of that? Okay, well, they yeah. haven't sent the notice to us yet that they've actually been made. So we'll get, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes
so
we are.
How about the county? Yeah. Have they did anything?
Yeah. So. Yeah. I'll find out about the county, but I did not realize the city had taken action. I apologize. It hadn't been forwarded to me yet, so I'll look into that. So.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Does this mean that we can sit in on the next meeting?
Yeah, I mean, your term is not up until the end of next month, just
yeah.
June 30.
Okay.
And then you can come the month after that, the month after that, the month after that. That's fine. We don't have a problem. Just be sitting. Any other announcements or new business, Becky? I'm sorry, Commissioner Winders.
Could you give us an update on the work program? What is it? How is it progressing?
So the work program is slated to go to City Council, I believe, June 20th.
Yep. All right. If nothing else, the chair will entertain a motion for adjournment. All those in favor, stand up and leave.